please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
This is Bazaar Morning Call, live from the CNBC TV18 headquarters in Mumbai.
Lenders need to be proactive in monitoring their borrowers and be able to identify financial stress.
The Reserve Bank stands by every clause, thus dashing hopes, widely prevalent hopes, that some of the rules would be tweaked.
You can't be making the banking system absolutely, you know, the perfect system for the perfect regulations for the perfect system. You need to get all the other systems also similarly aligned.
Tough trade-off between providing flexibility and having a rule-based system.
Government is saying that they are going to double the strength. So they are aware that without that, it will lead to a huge issue.
Our base case scenario or baseline scenario today would necessarily need to factor in the RBI's 12th circular.
Good morning. Welcome to Morning Call. I'm Lata, and with me, Anuj and Sonia. These cues put out by the Reserve Bank Deputy Governor already had a play yesterday and might find more play today. But today, I think the most important theme dominating markets is the global bullishness in commodities. Why commodity bullishness normally indicates positivity, because you're positive on growth. That's why you're positive on commodities. In a scenario like this, India tends to underperform because initially we face two headwinds. We face current account deficit headwinds and we face fiscal deficit headwinds. Of course, not to mention inflation headwinds. So initially, you already saw that impact yesterday. By the time we went to bed, the bond markets, after equity markets closed, had risen a goodish bit and the yields closed at 7.54. The rupee, I think, saw definitely RBI intervention. Otherwise, it had gone to 65, 78. But intervention smothered it a bit. Basically, we would be weaker on both those counts, bond and rupee, because of the way in which crude prices have reached now 2014 highs. So that is something today we have to take on board in no uncertain terms. And banking will continue with its weakness. Yield is one reason, but the continuing weakness of the Deputy Governor's speech. So today looks like we have to brace ourselves for some pressure on several pockets. Morning, both of you.
Hi, good morning. And that's something that we saw yesterday as well towards the end,
yes,
right? But I guess the only bright spot would be the earnings that have come through. From most of the big numbers that came in post-market hours yesterday, things looked very good, whether it was Mindtree, ACC, HDFC, Standard Life reported such a good
excellent
set of numbers. So I guess, you know, that's something that the street will take with both hands. But Anuj, morning, we saw big selling from FIs yesterday, almost 1,000 crores. I mean, selling from FIs has been something we are used to by now. But do you get a sense that the kind of pressure that we saw yesterday is something that could see follow through today as well?
Morning, Sonia. And, you know, yesterday I told you that, you know, the market would actually end in the red, or you know, the gap up would be the best time to sell yesterday, when it looked, you know, you have to play anti-consensus in this market. So it's very clear. So the SGX Nifty is indicating that we'll once again open in that resistance zone. This big buying by FIIs in index futures, so today may not be as bad as yesterday, though I think the adventurous traders would still try in the morning a short with yesterday's highest stop loss. I think that trade would be tried today. But if that trade fails, then perhaps, you know, the market could rally as well today. I think today is going to be a very difficult day, in a sense that there could be a lot of intraday volatility. Now, if the longs don't get follow through, yesterday, as I said, big buying by FIIs in index futures, and that was long position build up, then market could again fall, Sonia. So let's see how it moves. I think the Bank Nifty is important today, because yesterday it fell in late trade. But today you have the weekly options expiry on Bank Nifty, and the broad range is 25,000 to 25,200. So unless you have a big move in the first hour, it looks like you then have to, you know, really fade the boundaries in this 25,000-25,200 band on the Bank Nifty. But what last two or three days have once again proved is that while we're getting too fixated about the index, it's about individual stocks. You know, just look at FMCG and consumption stocks. Even yesterday, you know, stocks like Colgate ended at high point, Godrej Group ended at high point, Dabur, Marico, all these stocks. You know, for last many days, there's been big rally in Tata Global, United Breweries. It's getting a bit crowded right now, but that really is your space to focus on. And that's the one area which is in a bull market of its own. I think you focus on this space and you forget the Nifty and the Bank Nifty for some time. because we have run into resistance. If you take out 10,600, then I think you'll have a really huge short covering. But you know, there are some gap ups that you chase and there are some gap ups you avoid. I think today is the kind of gap up that you want to avoid, just like yesterday.
Okay. Well, if the Bank Nifty is able to make a turn because of expiry pressures or because it believes it has already internalized all the negatives in terms of the Reserve Bank rules and crude, then, you know, the market clearly has something positive going, because metals actually will react very positively today to the global commodity rally. And IT, if it takes a cue from Mindtree, should actually prepare for TCS with a positive hue. So that would keep two sectors happy. But really, we will have to wait and see whether banks are, you know, will stop reacting to both crude-led inflation as well as the RBI rules.
And crude is something that now we should really start worrying about, right? Highest level since 2014. And I was just reading this article where, you remember, that there was that supply cut deal that OPEC had come out with to boost prices. Apparently, Riyadh has put out a statement saying that, you know, they'll continue with that.
Absolutely.
So they would like to see oil at what, $80 a barrel.
You know, stockpiles draw down together have pushed it to $74. So 74 is something that the market will take time getting used to.
Oh, absolutely. And the ramifications it would have on our own markets as well. But let's take a look at what wise experts are telling us as we head into trade this morning. We have some comments coming in from Lawrence Belanco of CLSA. He says that a break above the 50-day moving average, currently at 10,463, would provide a fresh signal that the long-term uptrend is resuming. From a long-term perspective, he notes that the Nifty's breakout from the 2015 to 2017 consolidation pattern still suggests an ultimate upside target of 12,000, but advises that for now, look for ranging price action in the coming weeks.
Okay, and now for some rupee call. Mohan Chennoy of Kotak Mahindra Bank says the tit-for-tat trade tariffs on one side and prospects of US stocks with North Korea on the other have kept the dollar steady against majors. Rupee weakness in the last few days is due to rising crude oil prices, wider trade deficits and persistent import demand. Mohan expects the USD-INR to trade between 65.60 and 65.90 against the dollar today.
And on the bonds, Mohan Chennoy says that the local G-Sec market is trading on a dismal note, with yields rising mainly on account of rising oil prices, continued hawkish signal from the G3 central banks and the subdued market participation from major banks. He expects the yield on the 10-year benchmark to trade in a range of 7.53 to 7.58% today.
Okay. Okay, global markets doing well, especially the ones driven by commodities. Here's Sonal with the worldview.
Well, for the US market, it looked like a closed opening because the S&P, Nasdaq, they both closed in the green territory, but it was Dow Jones that saw some sort of red in towards the end of the trade. Biggest US companies reported strong quarterly numbers, and that was one of the reasons why we could see green on S&P and Nasdaq. But IBM, that was really the stock that pulled down to the red, and we could see steep losses in IBM, which even pushed the stock very low. CSX is one other stock that posted better than the estimated results and posted its highest surge since Jan 2017. United Airlines is another stock that posted strong results. While we were talking about strong rally in commodities, European stocks, all of them pushed higher because of strong rally in commodities across the globe. FTSE, DAX, all of them saw some green on the screen. They closed in the positive territory, and also earnings were another reason why we could see a green on them. Basic resources were the stocks that actually soared higher, but auto stocks were the worst performers in all the while in the trade. Talking about oil prices, now oil prices have extended their gains, and crude has now surged 3% to touch that $74 per barrel mark. So that is some cause of worry. But in the Asian markets, they are notching higher after decent earnings from the Wall Street. Nikkei, Hang Seng, Kospi, all are seeing some green on the screen as of now. And SGX Nifty, that is something that is indicating that is a positive start likely for our trade today as well.
Okay, thank you very much for that, Sonal. But, you know, we need to go over the world view in commodities as well more deeply. Manisha Gupta is joining us on the phone line. Manisha, it's not just crude, isn't it? Metals also, you're in with us in the office. It's not just crude, it's also metals, aluminum, nickel, everything surging.
Oh, well, absolutely, yes, Lata. And, you know, for some time, for last couple of years at least, we haven't seen commodities attract a lot of money. It really has been equities. But that really seems to have changed in last couple of months, especially because of the fundamental change as well. And most markets believing that the U.S. dollar will continue another year on a weaker side. And that really has been supportive. The crude prices, as we were just talking about, has so many fundamentals that have been supportive. $74 per barrel is a new 2014 highs that we have been trading at, starting right from the U.S. inventories, which have declined and have come down to a five-year average now, even as the U.S. output has been increasing, is supportive. And then, of course, the net long speculative positions are at an all-time highs when it comes to Brent. So it really is the money chasing the strong fundamentals, which has been supportive. And that clearly has been the case for the metals as a space as well. So you have the nickel prices trading at a three-year highs. And it's not just aluminum, which, by the way, has gained 25% in the month of April alone. Nickel prices also have gained 10% in last 15 days as well. This all has to do with the U.S. sanctions on Russia. It's not just Rusal, which looks at aluminum, but some of the nickel supplies also are expected to get hit, and that is what has been supporting that. Copper demand has been on the stronger side, so that one is trading at a one-month highs as well. Copper prices also are up 3% in this week itself. You have seen the zinc prices come back as the steel demand in China seems to be picking up for this quarter. So almost everything that you see in metal space is doing well. Of course, aluminum is the outperformer in all of that pack.
Okay, thanks a lot for that. And also, as we have been mentioning, further supporting oil prices is one expectation that the United States will reintroduce sanctions against the OPEC member Iran, which could result in further supply reductions from the Middle East. So a lot of that is really, you know, something that the street is talking about, as Manisha mentioned as well. We'll take a break. We'll discuss all of this with a guest on the other side. We will also come back with CNBC TV18's top 10 list of stocks to watch for the day. Hi guys, welcome to Bazaar Morning Call. Well, this morning, let's take a look at the SGX Nifty. It's indicating a positive start. Let's see how that goes. Our research team is here to tell you about the list of stocks to watch as we head into trade today. Anuj, what are you looking at today?
So a lot of stocks today, actually, Sonia. You know, yesterday, by the way, we spoke about Jet Airways, which ended at the low point and it entered the F&O band. So that, and there is some fresh news there again about, you know, passengers being compensated for flight delays. So entire aviation sector could be under pressure today because of crude. But I think the stock that I'm really watching for is Adani Enterprises. It's a stock which is in a bear market of its own. It's a stock which, you know, it has made a bit of a death cross. The moving average is clearly all over the place. And there's news now, and just a couple of news points that I was reading. It's a fresh protest from local groups in Australia about that mine that Adani is developing. And the treasurer has said that the Adani mine funding is off the table. So that way, I think there could be significant pressure on Adani Enterprises. Then, of course, I'm watching out for the FMCG stocks. We earlier discussed in the first segment also. Colgate, for example, that ended at high point yesterday. It's underperformed the FMCG index by 40% this year. It hasn't rallied at all this year, while the FMCG index has rallied about 40%. So, and there's this royalty report which could favor companies like Colgate. And yesterday it ended at the high point. It's trading below its median valuation. So, you know, this could be exactly this could be an interesting stock to watch out for. And we were discussing this entire space with Ms. Tulsian also yesterday, a stock like Godrej Industries. This, of course, is not a day call, but if you take a look at what Godrej Industries has done this year after the correction, its market cap is 20,000 crores, but if you look at its holdings, and that too, these are its subsidiaries, not just investments. Godrej Consumer is worth 18,500, property is worth 10,000, agro worth 8,000. And if you look at the stock moves, all these three stocks have moved big, 14 to 20%. But Godrej Industries has not done anything. It's actually down about 3%. So that could be an interesting stock to track going forward.
All right. Thanks for that, of course. FMCG anyway on a tear. But now let's get to results, those that came after market hours. Nigel, ACC, good numbers?
Well, the numbers look good, Latha. And, you know, towards the end of trade, the stock ended at the low point of the day. So you can expect an additional fillip. The numbers came very late at around 10 p.m. So some part of the street was wondering, is there something else that's coming? That didn't come about. The numbers came and they were very good. Mm-hmm. Sales volumes bang in line with what we were working with, 7.1 million tons. The surprise came on the realizations. On a sequential basis, it increased by 3%. Oh. We were working with more or less flattish realizations number. So that was a positive. Important to note that the cost rationalization as well is something that's playing out. So in terms of margin, we were working with a contraction. In fact, there's a mild expansion that primarily happened because top line growth of more than 10%. And in fact, total expenses were in fact down. The stock should open up in the green today.
Okay. While on the matter, just take us through global commodities. I mean, Manisha told us about nickel and aluminum and copper, so positive for those stocks.
Yeah, aluminum has had a dream run, Lata. In the last 10 days, aluminum prices globally have moved from $2,000 per ton to around $2,500 per ton. The stocks you're looking at is Hindalco, Vedanta and Nalco. Why is that? Point number one, Goldman Sachs, they say that even aluminum prices could go to around $3,000 per ton. So that's point number one. Point number two is Alcoa came out with a set of numbers. The numbers look good. More importantly, the guidance is very positive. They're expecting demand to shoot up for aluminum. And secondly, they're expecting better than expected deficit in terms of aluminum going ahead as well. So that's point number two. And in fact, point number three, Nalco is the stock in focus. Macquarie has come out with a note. They are saying they have a target price of around 77 rupees on a per share basis. But that's taking into account an EV upon a bit of around 6.5 times and taking aluminium prices at around $2,050 per ton and alumina prices at less than $400 per ton. We know that those prices are much higher. They are saying for every $100 move in aluminium and alumina, in fact, the fair value can spike to around 116 rupees per share. So keep in mind, just in the last hour of trade, Anuj as well was spotting it. These stocks had already rallied a bit towards the end of trade.
Okay, thanks a lot for that, Nigel. The big story, of course, will also be the spike up that we've seen in crude and the impact it would have on stocks.
Yeah, I mean, I guess everything is said on it. So just watch out for oil marketing companies, IOC, BBCL, HPCL, and concomitantly positive for ONGC and Oil India, and maybe even Aban Offshore.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes. By the way, there was also this report that private companies may have to share more with the government now that crude is rising again. So that would also be interesting. But Lata, this saga on ICICI Bank, Chanda Kochhar, it now looks like it's more a matter of when and not if.
Yes, sir. I mean, we know that mutual funds met ICICI Bank chairman, board members actually, and Business Standard reports. All this is what we have all got over phone. So Business Standard's report is that the chairman said institution is more important than the individual, and that is being read as an exit of the current MD. Now, going by how Axis Bank reacted, this should actually be positive, I say, because Axis Bank reacted positively when the news came out that the management will change.
Okay, we'll keep an eye out on that. But the aviation stocks, at the onset, we must mention that because of rising crude, you know, these stocks could be under pressure. Remember, 30 to 40% of their costs come from aviation turbine fuel and crude prices have been on the rise. But on the flip side, the passenger traffic growth has been very strong this month. So we've seen the fastest growth in the last 32 months for passenger traffic in the month of March. It's a growth of 28% that we've seen overall, 11.58 million passengers. And you'll get a trend. Look at how the trend has been improving in passenger traffic growth. So that, you know, is really important for them in terms of market share. That's the data coming in on market share as well. It's important to note that IndiGo has maintained its market share about 39.5 or so. SpiceJet has increased it marginally, but by and large, most of them, you know, stay in that same range. But as I mentioned, because of rising crude, you could see some pressure.
Yes, I think Jet in particular should be under pressure, though SpiceJet could be interesting. And IndiGo, of course, has resumed that leadership role and has been the best performing stock. But Mindtree, how much of the this is in the price? The stock has, of course, doubled over the last 1 year or so. But Reema will tell us about that. Reema?
Hi, Anuj. Good morning. Well, Q4 was a big beat compared to expectations. So the company's delivered a dollar revenue growth of 5.5% versus estimates of 4%. Margins expanded by 100 basis points. Their profits beat expectations by more than 23%. Even the management commentary for the next year was positive, with the company saying that revenue growth and margins will be better than what we saw in FY18. The only concern in the numbers is that a large portion of the revenue growth came in from the top line, and the order book, 80% of the order book will be executed in the next 1 year. But on the whole, this quarter is good. The commentary for the next quarter is good. But a lot of it could be in the price, with the stock at record levels and trading at 20 times FY20 PE, one of the most expensive in the IT pack.
All right. Thank you very much, Reema. And we'll touch base with you on TCS as well. Abhishek, HDFC Life numbers were very good.
Lata, they reported a very strong set of numbers if you look at sequential growth. So the first year premium growth was about 44% on a quarter-on-quarter basis. That led to gross premium growing by almost 64% on a sequential basis. So the net profit on account of strong top line actually grew by 69% YOY and 102% quarter-on-quarter. One flip side to the results were that there was a loss in terms of mark-to-market loss, as the debt portion in their overall AUM mix has actually increase. However, 13-month persistency ratio continues to be above 85%, while 61st-month persistency ratio actually declined owing to the 2013, wherein they had a lower first-year income. CLSA maintains a buy recommendation with a target price of 580. Back to you.
Okay, thanks a lot for that. NMDC is also on our radar. Nigel, why is that?
NMDC is on our radar because they've cut prices by around 100 rupees per ton. Remember, at the start of this month, they were expected to cut prices. They didn't cut prices, but now it appears that domestic supply has increased from Odisha. Odisha miners had already cut prices by around 200 to 300 rupees per ton. NMDC themselves have increased capacity in Karnataka. So higher supply, that's what's forced them to cut prices by 100 rupees per ton on lumps as well as fines.
Okay. Nisha, Fortis board meeting today.
Oh, yes, but right before the board, Lata board meet today, the FII is holding 12%, have sought to dismantle the present board of Fortis Healthcare and have even asked for an EGM for the formation of a new board. In fact, it's so detailed that now they have also given the names of some of the independent directors who should be on the board of Fortis Healthcare. So it really needs to be seen if the present board in this circumstance can go ahead and take a big decision today on the offers that have come for Fortis Healthcare. That needs to be seen. Eastbridge Capital, National Westminster Bank have all come in with their 12% stake and have asked for a board change. So let's see what happens. In the meantime, IHH has given another supplemental offer and says that 4,000 crore rupees of preferential allotment can be done.
Okay, thank you very much for that. And do credit to Ekta. She even wrote an edit piece in CNBCTV18.com that how can this lame board take such a big decision? All of four members. Anisha, more stocks on your list?
Oh, well, yes. A lot of the companies have signed contracts, and that's why I expect all of them to be in green to top it all. We have Infibeam, who has signed a contract with National Skill Development Corporation, so that should hold up in the green. Drugen Techno has signed three separate contracts. The timeline is anywhere between 3 to 6 years. Improve revenue visibility, that should hold up in the green. Lemon Tree, they have also signed three management contracts for a hotel in Uttarakhand. So good news coming in for Lemon Tree as well. Power Dynamics, they have signed a licensing agreement with DRDO. And this is for Astra MK1 weapon system. Now, that should bode well for the company and definitely should hold up in the green. Green Eastern Shipping, they had signed a contract earlier to take delivery of the gas carrier, and that is what they've got now. We see sentimental impact on the stock usually, so that should also hold up in the green. Lastly, Sun Pharma, good news there, because the US FDA has given a nod for the allergy drug, and that should also hold up in the green. Back to you.